Holiday your heart out at oldnavy.com with jeans on sale for one day only today. That's right, Old Navy jeans are just $10 for adults and $8 for kids and toddlers. Online only at oldnavy.com. Valid 11/26, select styles only.
Gather around, my friends, to the show that never ends. Join us as we go on our quest. We will wake the sleeping dragon on our way on the hunt for White Christ. And joining...
He couldn't stop himself, folks. As much as he should have let that joke die before we went on air, he could not do it.
Nope.
Nope.
Joining me on the hunt for White Christ, I, of course, am your mandated reporter, and frankly, I'm a silly ass, Mr. Mark Rattledge. Anyway, joining me on the hunt for White Christ as we wake the sleeping dragon is the perpetually mortified Mr. Jesse Starcher. How do you do, sir?
What little does Unleashed know, they have now begun a sequel to The Hunt for Red October. Instead, it's a submarine that patrols the bottom of the sea in the ever elusive search for the White Christ. What the hell, man? Unleashed, like I said, I don't know who the hell these guys are, and you decide to, which I should now, by the way, Swedish death metal band. It seems to be one of the more prominent genres that I find myself falling into lately, but now, when is this coming out? Is it already out? Has it already been bestowed upon the public?
Right, let's see here. I actually have the website up. Let us look and see when the hunt for White Christ shall begin. It actually has already begun. October 26th is when Unleashed their hunt for White Christ, which is their latest album.
Geraldo Rivera should be on the scene at any point. I think they have found him. Okay.
You want to know what else came out?
Tell me.
October 26th.
When? What?
Bloodbath. The Arrow of Satan is Drawn.
Gosh. Never heard of that band either.
The Browning. Geist.
The Browning? Is that the name of the band? Or Geist, yes, is the name of the... Okay. No, All right.
First I'm going to tell you the band, then the album.
I gotcha.
Chevelle, 12 Bloody Spies, which is a compilation album.
Interesting.
Cryptopsy, The Book of Suffering, Tome 2, which is an EP.
Sounds tasty.
Fifth Angel, The Third Secret. Not The First Secret, The Third Secret.
Too many numbers! Fifth Angel, doing math.
Haken, Vector. What's your Vector, Victor?
Sure.
Hate Eternal. Really? You don't know what's your Vector, Victor?
Is this an airplane joke?
Yes.
Oh, thank goodness. I actually nailed it.
Yes.
Had no idea.
It wasn't Family Guy or the Monty Python.
Shirley, you jest. No,
don't call me Shirley. Hate Eternal, Upon Desolate Sands, Icarus, okay. Witch, Goodbye, Cruel World. It's a song about... it's an album about suicide.
Oh, that's sad.
I don't really know that for sure.
Okay.
Into Eternity, The Sirens. Okay. KMFDM, doing it again. A treat for the freaks. Truth or dare. Are you ready for this, Jessie Starcher? We don't care. Live in the USSA. It's a live album.
Oh, interesting.
Mass Hysteria, Maniac, Serenia, Arcane Astral Aeons.
Nope.
Skullfist, that's the name of your new band.
Okay.
Way of the Road.
Sure.
I'm curious about something. Skullfist are a Canadian heavy metal band formed in Toronto. Ted Poley, Modern Art. The aforementioned Unleashed, The Hunt for White Christ. Which gets my vote for best album name of the year, by the way.
Oh, man. Are these guys... do they have? Have you listened to much of Unleashed?
Yeah,
are they racist, or are they just having fun making a statement against, of religion? Is that, I assume that's probably their stance, considering we just talked about the whole upside down cross thing in their name. Much of an idea of what their position is.
And lastly,
That was a question, but go right ahead and keep going.
Well, I don't know what their politics are. First of all, the only reason why we're doing this bit is because I like to repeat ad nauseum The Hunt for White Christ.
Oh, that's right. I should have known it was that simple. I should have never asked for any answers.
I don't do research. Research are for fags and nerds.
All right. Are you offended yet, public? Because we've got more coming. There's a whole hour and a half left, I guarantee you.
Warrel Dane, Shadow Work. And that was everything that came out October 26th.
Oh, wow. Before Halloween.
Yeah, if we had more weeks in the year, or I didn't want to do the Rocky IV soundtrack or last year's Tarja Christmas album, we would be reviewing Unleashed, The Hunt for White Christ.
Okay.
But instead, we're moving on to November 2nd. Which gave Sick of It All, hardcore New York legend, Sick of It All, with their album Wake the Sleeping Dragon, Jessie Starcher. Are you excited?
Oh, absolutely, man. We had a good time on the Metal Hammer of Doom Extra, catching up on three videos from the history of this band. So I was really stoked to get into Waking the Sleeping Dragon, or Wake the Sleeping Dragon here, from a band that I don't know anything about, not a thing. I don't know if I've heard a Sick of It All song. I know the three videos that you put together for us was nothing that I had seen before. So, yeah, I'm ready to talk about this album because I think there's quite a bit to talk about, actually.
So I'll tell you something else about Sick of It All that you might not know. One of their earlier songs was named It's Clobberin' Time.
Oh, nice.
And when CM Punk would yell out, "It's clobbering time," before his matches, it was because he was referencing Sick of It All, which was referencing The Thing.
Oh, I did not know that. I figured he was a big Thing fan.
I think it's all like one big Venn diagram, but he was specifically doing it because CM Punk, as we all know, is a hardcore punk. Sick of It All are hardcore punks, and they are both comic book fans.
Oh, very, very interesting. And I'm a big CM Punk fan. As a matter of fact, my son's first two initials are CM, so I go around calling him CM Starch every once in a while.
Does he sit Indian style and complain that he doesn't get enough pushes?
He complains he doesn't get enough candy.
Oh, wow.
That happens quite often.
So I'm coming to New York. Not that that should matter to you. You live in Ohio, Langford, Ohio. It's like a zillion miles away.
Yes.
So I'll be in New York for WrestleMania, which I found out today. And why was I telling you the story?
We went from CM Punk, WrestleMania.
I couldn't remember words last night. Now I'm like... Now I'm like losing stories midway through. Wow, I'm probably dying.
Just make sure it's on a podcast so we can actually get some ratings.
Yeah, man,
as you're on your way out.
Man dies on podcast while searching for White Christ. Film at 11.
Well, So you, if you remember why you were going to tell that story, you could jump back to it any time. But
yeah, there was a reason. It was related to what we were talking about, and I've completely lost it.
Are you going to WrestleMania?
I am. My friend got us tickets today, so I got to buy a plane ticket. And now I remember why I was telling you that story. So I was talking to my wife. I said, "Hey, you know my friend John Freak Boy. He got two tickets to WrestleMania. One of them is for me." So we were starting to talk about, you know, buying a plane ticket and, you know, planning and paying for everything, and just kind of like letting her in on what was going on. And I happened to say this in front of Jonas, and Jonas was like, "Oh, can I come?" And I refrained from yelling, "Hell no." I said, "No, you know, this is a trip that Daddy's going on by himself, and I'm not taking anyone with me, not even Mommy. But, you know, I know that I think Raw's coming to Tampa, like, right after Christmas. Like sometime in the beginning of January. And I'm pretty certain, Raw's coming to Orlando. And so my Melissa's rich aunt and uncle usually get us tickets to whatever is in Orlando. And if it's wrestling, we usually get wrestling tickets. Like, I've gone to see the Royal Rumble, SmackDown, a couple of things that were in Orlando. The last UFC fight in Orlando, they got me tickets for. That's like my yearly Christmas present, whatever's coming to Orlando.
Okay.
Because they have season tickets, like season box seats. So they just give us their box seats, basically.
Okay.
So with that being said, I think, you know, Aunt Debbie and Uncle Michael are going to get us tickets to go see wrestling in January. And he's like, "Well, when's January?" This just goes back and forth. But yeah, he was very, sad that, I was going to go see wrestling without him, which makes me kind of happy because I feel like, okay, he's really getting into it now. Like, I'm starting to see some genuine interest here.
Yeah, that's really cool. I mean, I don't know. See, my son wants to do things, and I'm right there with you. I'm like, "Oh, geez, I don't know, man." Like, you know, my wife pitched an idea about taking them on vacation, and this would be the first time Caleb would get to go. Usually, it's just the girls, my mom and Mindy and Kira.
Right.
Well, you know, she was like, "Well, I'm thinking about taking Caleb, and we might actually go down to Florida this time. Titusville is where my grandpa lives." So I was like, "You know what? Good luck, because I will not be a part of that. I love my family. I love everybody involved here. I even love my grandpa, but down to taking Caleb in a car for 16-hour drive is probably on the bottom of the list of things that I would want to do in my entire life."
Can I pitch you on why you should come to Florida?
Why? Say that again.
Can I pitch you on why you should come to Florida?
Tell me why I should, Mark Rattles.
I mean, look, it's an easy fix, first of all. Give him a tablet. Problem solved. Okay.
You think so? That's really putting a lot of faith into electricity and electronics there. Go ahead.
No, I've seen it with my own kids. Like, it is a solve that soothes. No matter what their issues are, if you just give them an electronic device, you will lose them for hours.
Okay. All right.
But I'm here. See?
I know.
If you come down to Florida, even as far as Orlando, we make trips, Jesse Starcher. I meet people halfway.
I hear you. If I get a chance to head down to Florida, trust me, you are going to be one of the first ones to know. But here's the thing, Mark Rattles.
Yeah, you owe me at least one kick in the balls, so.
If I'm coming down there, okay, it's going to be me and maybe another adult. Zero kids going to be involved because I will have no sanity and maybe in jail before I get to Florida.
If you fly down to Orlando, I will meet you at the airport, but I'll be holding a sign that says White Christ.
That's me!
All right.
That sign's for me.
Has anyone seen White Christ? All right. I think we've used up enough time in our opening silliness here. Let's get to Sick of It All, Wake the Sleeping Dragon. Now, folks, you've listened to the show before. We usually play a song, talk about it, play a song, talk about it. Occasionally, if there's a lot of tracks, we will play more than one song. So
That's what we're going to do tonight. There's 19 tracks. These are like a minute long, though. So we're going to play 30 seconds to a minute of each song. We're going to play three songs in a row, and then break, and then the next three songs. All right?
I'm ready.
Are you ready for the...
Say it. Death Jam something or other. I don't know what... Some kind of reference.
Are you ready for the Def Jam chore? Let me hear you make some noise for Public Enemy. But I was once again going to do the White Christ thing because, you know... You know. Come here, horsey.
There he goes. That poor horse.
All right.
Oh, boy. I'm ready. Let's go.
All right. Here we go. Our first three songs here are Inner Vision, That Crazy White Boy Shit, which I think they did a video for, and The Snake Break Free. Again, that was Inner Vision, That Crazy White Boy Shit, you know, and The Snake Break Free.
Whew. Well, okay, so here is my first full treat to Sick of It All. And, this is just a taste of what we're getting ready for the rest of on this album. And I would say of the three songs, the one that stuck out most to me is The Snake. I liked the way that it started. I liked the way that it sounded. If you guys can't tell yet, Sick of It All is frantic, in-your-face, New York hardcore. So, Mark Radulich.
You're at a disadvantage with this because, you've never really been into the punk scene. I sent you a whole punk mix last year, mm-hmm. if I remember correctly. Didn't I do that?
Yeah, we did that.
Yeah. And some of it you liked, and I think I put on the wrong Shelter song, and you were like, "That's the worst thing I've ever heard."
I do remember that. I'm like, "What the fuck?"
So, and it was interesting to see what tickled your fancy, and what didn't. I said you got to go back and listen to the entire Scratch the Surface album. It's probably the most accessible Sick of It All album there is. But if you listen to Scratch the Surface, I think you get a different feel for what. I think you get a feel for. You're led to believe Sick of It All is something that it really isn't. Listening to these first three tracks off Wake the Sleeping Dragon, this is Sick of It All. Sick of It All is a hardcore punk band. You know, it's frenetic, it's frantic. Everything feels like you should be circle pitting. You know, and it's not necessarily like Scratch the Surface is a little has a little bit more medley to it, melody to it rather than the rest of the Sick of It All catalog. Mm-hmm.
There is, in The Snake, I think this is the kind of song that sticks out to me because of the lyrics in it and the message that it's getting across. If you listen to some of the songs off this album are very positive and very, very supportive. They got a great support sound to them, or a supported message in a good bit of their songs. This is one of them. This is just a song. The Snake is about, I think, trying to resist temptation in some way, and it's like a song that kind of says, "Hey, you know, you can do it. You can make it through whatever's tempting you today, whether it be drugs or alcohol or something like that." At first, I thought it was a song about depression, but the more that obviously the snake is a representation of temptation, so that makes a little bit more sense to me. But I like the way it sounded too. It's, by the way, ladies and gentlemen, not a single song off of this album is going to breach 3 minutes.
Nope.
It's apparently representative of what this sound is. I mean, I know most punk songs are really short, in your face, in and out, ready to go. First three, I'm down. Go ahead.
Let me ask you a question. In your area of Langford, Ohio, is there like references to like a founder or you know somebody who like really built up the town?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so
Rufus Putnam.
Okay, so tell us about Rufus Putnam.
Rufus Putnam was one of the I want to say he was a general, but either way, he helped found the town. You know, we had Fort Harmer on the other side of town, and from there, if you look at the town of where we live, I don't want to break the mystique of Langford,
Langford, Ohio.
But you'll notice that it is one of the first towns ever established in the state of Ohio. So yeah, Rufus Putnam was one of the ones that helped build the fort and you know, get as many people here. One of the founders of our town.
All right. So where I live in Long Island, there was Robert Moses.
Oh my gosh, we are going to be talking about this guy soon because. That was the one dude that I was like, who the hell is this guy? And boy, did I go down a rabbit hole.
Oh, you actually did the research on this one?
I did, dude. I know exactly what you're going to talk about. Right. We're going to talk about racism, and we're going to talk about city planning.
Yes. So so where I grew up, there was Robert Moses State Park, and there was Robert Moses Parkway, and I think there was a beach that was named after him. So, you know, I grew up with the name Robert Moses all around me. And he was responsible for a lot of the building. And I'm looking at his Wikipedia page. And so, for those that don't know, he was born in 1888. And he died when I was, like, 5 years old, 1981. He was an American public official who worked mainly in the New York metropolitan area, known as the master builder of the mid-20th century New York City, Long Island, Rockland County, and Westchester County. He is sometimes compared to Baron Haussmann of the Second Empire Paris and was one of the most polarizing figures in the history of urban development in the United States. His decisions favoring highways over public transit helped create the modern suburbs of Long Island and the modern traffic jams that used to drive me crazy and influenced a generation of engineers, architects, and urban planners who spread his philosophies across the nation despite his not having trained in those professions. Moses would call himself a coordinator, and he was referred to in the media as Master Builder.
Oh, okay. All right. So, now are you setting us up for these next few songs?
Yes, that was the whole point of
okay.
that.
Okay. All right, good, because I was going to say you're giving it away just a little too early if that's the case. Well, I cannot wait to talk a little bit more about this guy, because I never even heard of this dude until today. And next thing you know, I'm on the internet doing research.
So, should I talk about his legacy, or should I wait for that?
Let's wait, because we need to we need to hear this bit of a song when we get to it, and then we'll go into it.
Okay. Here, I have it pulled up here, the racism section of his Wikipedia page.
Oh,
terrific. All right, so what we're talking about here is first the Bulls anthem, then the whole reason I brought that up, there's a track on here called Robert Moses Was a Racist, and it would make sense that they would talk about Robert Moses and try to bring him down because they are from New York, and he obviously was a huge figure in New York City and Long Island. And then, speaking of Robert Moses, self-important shithead. So, there we are. Those are our next three tracks. Here we go with the Bulls anthem. You keep it out of reach. Bobby, you cheat. You keep it out of reach. Go. Oh, say, can you see? Oh, can you see? Can you see me? Yes, I'm so lucky. All right, it's enough of that. Jessie Starcher, Robert Moses was a racist.
Oh, man. So I even wrote something out here in my notes because this song, when I heard it today, I was like, who is this guy and why do they hate him? I don't understand what's going on. Why are we all of a sudden calling this dude a racist? Obviously, there's a story here. And it led me down this interesting rabbit hole that I really wish I had more time for.
Like, people didn't get their unemployment checks today because of this, I'll bet.
No, I waited to do my research at home. I'm a good I'm a good worker, sir. I have the public interest at heart. So they make me go and look up this Robert Moses character. And soon I'm enveloped in a world of city design and racism. I'm like, what in the hell? And it's a fascinating story. And I would suggest anybody out there that's interested in something like this, go check it out. You can find some pretty interesting stuff online. As a matter of fact, I went to citylab.com. Now, let me read to you a little something here that they were talking about. He was, I'll read this opening paragraph. This summer, as New Yorkers head out to Long Island's beach towns and parks on the Southern State Parkway, they'll pass beneath a series of overpass bridges made infamous in Robert A. Cairo's monumental 1974 biography of Robert Moses, the Power Broker. So that's, I guess, where you could start. You can read that story. But one of the quotes that I pulled out of here, it says, according to Cairo, who described Moses as the most racist human being I had ever really encountered, the evidence is legion. Minority neighborhoods bulldozed for urban renewal projects, simian-themed details in a Harlem playground, elaborate attempts to discourage non-whites from certain parks and pools. He complained of his work sullied by that scum floating up from Puerto Rico. So, yeah. Now, City Lab, this whole article is dedicated
You might say that Robert Moses was hunting for white Christ.
And the search continues this day, and Unleashed has picked up that sword and continued forth. So, yeah, City Lab, now the article itself is actually talking about how complex this guy actually was. And maybe there wasn't a whole lot to this whole racism thing. Now, that's one person's take, but either way, I mean, Mark, you grew up there. Is this something that you heard over and over? Was he like, this Robert Moses is a, you know, he's a racist shithead or what?
But all the white people in Long Island were racist too, so they I'm sure, you know, they would have just held him up on their fucking shoulders.
Ah, yes.
Being Look, there. let me tell you something about white people, okay? Mm-hmm. White people went to war in World War II, okay? They left their city homes. They left their homes in Manhattan, you know, when people could still live there. And they went to go fight in Europe, and they went to go fight in, you know, overseas in Japan, in Italy, in Africa. And they got something called the GI Bill.
Mm, heard of that, yep.
And when they came home, those that made it went to college and were able to buy homes. And did they buy homes in Queens? No. Did they buy homes in Brooklyn? No. Did they buy homes in the... You know where I'm going with this. They bought homes in the suburbs of Long Island. First in Nassau County, and then when the Mullions, when the Schmuggies, when...
What are you speaking now?
This
horribly, horribly inappropriate, but go ahead.
When the colored folk... moved with their vast riches that they had gained from Brooklyn and Queens and Manhattan and the Bronx, and they moved into Nassau County. The white people said, fuck you. And they moved into Levittown, and they moved into Massapequa, and they, you know, continued to then move into Suffolk County. And then the more black people started to move east, out of the city and more into Long Island, as more black people and more Puerto Ricans flooded into Western Long Island, more white people took their shit and ran as far out east as possible.
Oh, jeez.
Okay? And eventually black people followed them into Suffolk County, too. But you know, by that point, you know, there was nowhere else to go except the water.
Say, you're going right in the ocean now. Okay.
Now I'm not going to tell you that there weren't some white people that were considering building their homes in the ocean, but just to not be around black people. But I think after a while, white flight stopped. And, you know, that was the end of that. Now it's kind of going.
Is that what it was called? Was white flight?
You've never heard the concept of white flight?
Oh my gosh, man. This is such an educational podcast sometimes. Never heard that term.
Oh, Jessie.
I obviously figured it out now.
Did you have any white flight in Langford, Ohio?
I can't say that I've ever seen it happen. Obviously, if I knew what the term was, I would have been able to figure it out. But no, I can say that is not...
If you look up white flight in the... Oh, my God, there's a book. There's a whole book called White Flight. White flight is a term that originated in the United States starting in the 1950s and 60s and applied to the large-scale migration of people of various European ancestries from racially mixed urban regions to more racially homogenous suburban or ex-urban regions.
Very interesting.
Yeah. So
okay. All right. So, yeah, back to, you know, city planning and racism. You know... So this guy was heralded, I assume, by some.
Yeah,
and
none of the fucking Italians wanted to live among the black folk.
Okay.
And so while they tried, desperately tried to get away from them, and ultimately failed. I'm distracted by the amount of Facebook stuff that just got.
I just noticed this Rattlesnake Broadcasting Network from
2013.
It gets a comment on there. Okay. All right. And Batman is her biggest fan, apparently. I'm scared to even click on this lady just to see what she's trying to sell.
Yeah, I just tried to fucking close it.
And everything.
Yeah,
okay.
I closed it down. Anyway, all right, back to the podcast. So, you know, so you're asking, like, did people know? Either they didn't know or didn't care, basically. Like, I don't remember. Like, my father knew who Robert Moses was, and my father is very fond of, like, you know, pointing things like the Teapot Dome scandal, and, you know, all the various famous scandals of New York City in the 1900s. You know, any idea what Teapot Dome was?
Nope, no clue.
All right, go look it up. But
I think I'm gonna have to start looking shit up because this is damn interesting.
There's another. There's something else that was like very famous that was like related to Teapot Dome. But you know, like all the rampant scandals and shit that were going on in the 1900s. Like my father was very would bring that stuff up all the time. That's how I learned about it. But like I don't remember him saying, and Robert Moses was a terrible racist. Like I don't know. Like, I think people were more thankful for the roads, so it didn't so much care about his personal politics.
Well, either way, Sig of It All has an opinion here.
Yeah, they do. Right?
They aren't afraid of it. I know these guys have been around for 30 years, but I assume, obviously, in the punk landscape, having an opinion is just, you know, it goes hand in hand.
Does having an opinion about a guy that died in 1981 really matter in 2018?
Listen, it got me on the internet looking things up.
Are you going out to Long Island now to like fucking burn down Robert Moses State Park?
No.
in the name of like hashtag Me Too? I don't know. Like what the fuck? What is the point of any of this?
No, it does seem odd. But like I said, it just felt like, man, you know, the purpose of them pointing that out was to get people like me to go, what are they talking about? And actually look into it and educate themselves.
Okay, so the five people who bought this album when it came out, right?
Yeah.
I don't think bothered to look up who Robert Moses was.
Well, you know what? I count me among those five then. I may not have bought the album, but I've definitely listened to it, and it made me try and figure out who this guy was. So
let me ask you a question, in all seriousness. Okay. All right. Black people move next door. No. Just kidding. Just kidding. But if you didn't have a podcast where you talked about the album, like if you just passively listened to the music, would you have looked up who Robert Moses was?
That's a very good possibility. I'm curious by nature in regards to stuff like that because, first off, you already said it. Why the hell would they? Why is it such a big deal to make a damn song about it and put it on your album? Well, right there's the hook for me because I'm like, okay, this is obviously important for some reason. Why would they have done it? And I think they knew that going into it. So, yeah, I probably would have looked it up. If I would have caught this in passing or if I would have said, okay, well, I'm listening to the Sick of It All album today, I would have been like, who the fuck is this guy and why are they so upset?
Well,
so, yes.
I'll tell you the other side of that, though, is, you know, it's like, hang on. Alexa.
Uh-oh.
Who's Robert Moses?
Robert Moses was an American public official who worked mainly in the New York metropolitan area. Known as the master builder of mid-20th century New York City, Long Island, Rockland County, and Westchester County, he is sometimes compared to Baron Osman of Second Empire Paris, and is one of the most polarizing figures in the history of...
Alexa, read his Wikipedia, please.
And so, the other side of it is it's so easy to look stuff up now that, you know, maybe people, you know, just like, hey, Google, hey, Alexa, hey, fuck you... Well, you know, tell me a thing, and then just move on with their life. And it's like a quick 30 seconds out of their life while they're waiting to take a piss.
Dude, if I had musical talent, if I had musical talent, I would seriously make a song that said like Rufus Putnam shit in my bed, and then everybody would be like trying to figure out what is this guy talking about. Boom, history.
Who is Rufus Putnam? Why is he shitting in people's bed? Tell me why is Dick Cheney underneath my bed? No,
and
sir,
apparently,
that ain't cool.
Robert Moses is, according to Sig of It All, the reason why there is no Brooklyn Dodgers. I don't understand, but I'm sure that's another little tidbit because they throw that.
I didn't know about that. Like, I knew that the. I know. Ask me why I know that the Dodgers moved out of Brooklyn.
Why? Oh, okay. Why do you know this?
Why do I know what?
Why do you know why the Brooklyn Dodgers moved out?
Of where?
Of Brooklyn.
Thank why are they you. Not? Jesus Christ! Right? Yeah, make a complete sentence, sir.
Fuck you! Tell me why.
Because it was the end of my father watching baseball.
Oh, really?
Yeah, my father quit watching baseball when the Dodgers moved out of Brooklyn. Ask me why I know that.
Why do you know that?
He fucking tells everyone. That's why. Literally, just he, I have
he
tickets.
He does the same shit you just did to me. He makes everybody ask him and repeat the question, and then he tells them right in their face.
Well, it's like literally like hey, I'm gonna go check out. I'm gonna go watch the Met game. Oh, Met game. You know, I used to be a fan of the Brooklyn Dodgers. Want to know why I'm not a fan of the Brooklyn Dodgers anymore?
Ask me why.
I have been hearing him tell that story. I have been hearing him whine about the Brooklyn Dodgers, and it's so funny because like when you think about like. These sports teams, like, did you ever see the beginning of basketball?
No, but you can go ahead and summarize for me, please.
All right, so the beginning of basketball talks about like team, like players and teams moving. They do a whole like diagram of all these teams moving to different states or whatever. And it's like, and the New Orleans Jazz moved to Utah where they don't allow music. Things like that, you know, like I think it was like the Hartford North Stars moved to Dallas, they just became the Stars and shit like that. Mm-hmm. The point of the whole beginning of basketball is that because of money has kind of ruined sports basically, and you don't have the affection or the attachment to teams like you used to. Well, that is pretty much my whole dad's thing with the Brooklyn Dodgers. He was like, it's like they like fucking shattered his interest in baseball. Not that I think he had a lot to begin with. I think he overplays, like, the whole story. You know, it wasn't like he was born with a bat and glove in his hand, and then it was like, but the Dodgers moved out of Brooklyn, and he, like, threw him down in protest. I don't believe it was that heavy. But, you know, I think his point was, like, that was the hometown team, the Brooklyn Dodgers, and then they moved to Los Angeles, and he was like, well, you can't count on anything or anybody, become an accountant. I mean, that's the only reason I can think of.
Hmm. Well, that's affected him pretty deeply, it sounds like. Definitely.
The Dodgers moved out of Brooklyn. There is no God except for White Christ.
All hail White Christ. The search continues.
Now you're getting it.
Oh, jeez.
Hey, how was the latest episode of the Metal Hammer of Doom? I don't know. The one asshole host is really obsessed with this new Unleashed album.
Which we are not going to cover, right? That's not on the calendar.
Not at all.
We're just going to talk about it.
Not even a little bit. I'm going to talk more about the new Unleashed album than I am about Sick of It All and Robert Moses.
Oh, no.
All right.
All right. What's the next three, Mark Radulich?
They're less interesting than Robert Moses, I'll tell you that much. To the Wolves, Always With Us, and our title track, Wake the Sleeping Dragon. They threw me to the wall.
Remember when we got that awful call?
Okay, that was To the Wolves, Always With Us, and Wake the Sleeping Dragon. I think Always With Us so far is my favorite track.
Yeah, it's a good one. Great, great tribute song to some fallen friends, and it sounds good too. So yeah, I could dig that. It's probably a top five for me off this album. Wake the Sleeping Dragon, buddy. That's you can't beat a song that starts out with Nazis. I mean, you know that Sick of It All has an agenda to speak out on some things.
You might even say that they're tired of it.
They might be tired of it. So, yeah, this is our Nazi punching anthem, Wake the Sleeping Dragon.
Because every song must have, every album must have one.
Oh, yeah, that's right. And, you know, there's, I heard a great, what is it called? Josh and Chuck, the Stuff You Should Know podcast. There we go. Sorry, couldn't think of it. Stuff You Should Know podcast on anarchism. And this is, you know, I don't think they're preaching anarchism here in any way. They're obviously preaching about, you know, stand up against the man, the Nazis.
Make sure that you protect yourself against the full frontal attack.
Some great stuff. I want to watch that video right now. Oh, it's good stuff. But anyway, yeah, you know, it says, we're the ones in power if we're organized. Fight back, resist, stand up, persist, wake the sleeping dragon in the middle of the night. So a lot of power, a lot of message, a lot of rally cry through a good bit of their songs. And Wake the Sleeping Dragon, title track, and probably one of the – they probably feel one of the more important tracks off of here.
So I think the algorithm that on Spotify that does the song recommendations, so like your playlist, is broken or dumb.
What's going on?
Sick of It All, Wake the Sleeping Dragon. I created a playlist of just that album, and then underneath is recommended songs for your playlist. There's two recommendations, right?
Okay.
Two bands. First one, Imagine Dragons.
Oh, come on.
I'm not joking about that. This is not a bit.
That is horrible. That is a horrible algorithm right there.
And then the next one is called Little Dragon. So you say...
Are you... What the hell is Little Dragon? I'm just curious. I'm looking it up right now because I want to know if it's... That looks interesting. Okay. Little Dragon, we'll tell you right now about Little Dragon. They're from their breakout 2011 album Ritual Union to last year's Season High via 2014's Grammy-nominated Naboomah Rumber Band. I have no fucking
God bless
clue.
You.
I don't know what this is. Where are they? They are listened to in London, Great Britain, Los Angeles, New York, San Francisco, and Mexico City. I don't know much about them, though. So, never heard of them.
They probably didn't care when the Dodgers left Brooklyn.
Yakumi, having lent her trademark vocals to the likes of Gorillaz, SB Trekt, Bad Bad Not Good, Bloom De La Soul, and
Gorillaz as in, I'm happy, I'm feeling sad, I got sunshine in a bag. That Gorillaz?
No, I'm afraid not.
Oh.
I don't know. De La Soul and K Tronada.
Oh, shit. Me, myself, and I. Boot, doot, 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 doot.
That's good stuff right there. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, not a very good matchup, in my opinion, with Sick of It All.
No, it seemed almost the opposite.
There are, like, three bands that I know that could probably be, you know, much more related. I don't know shit about this genre. New York hardcore is something that I've not gotten into very much. So, you know, but I know we've talked to quite a few Nazi slugging bands just this year.
Either Nazi slugging or fucking in a UFO. That's what this podcast is all about.
Oh, yeah, baby.
All right. Our next three songs are 2 Plus 2, Beef Between Vegans, which gets my vote for best fucking track of the night.
Yes. Yes, please.
And Hardcore Horseshoe. Here we go.
Feels my head, I pick my spots, don't get me started. Life in transit, slides and drains of mental.
Plus two, beef between vegans and hardcore horseshoe.
So, two things, all right? First thing I want to talk about is beef between vegans, which is, like you said, probably the greatest title of a song off of this album. But not only that, Mark Radulich, but it contains probably one of the best lyrics off of this album. And there's some good stuff. Don't get me wrong. But listen, I'm going to read this to you right now, okay? You ready?
Okay.
Here we go. There will be tanks on Thanksgiving while we're flipping the bird. There will be conflict. Now, wait. There will be beef between vegans. Get ready for this. Like a spongiform herd, okay? Now, I'm asking you, Mark Radulich, do you know what spongiform is?
Yes.
Okay. This is the point where I get to go, okay, tell me what it's about, because I want to call you on your bullshit. Tell me what spongiform is.
It's a form of a sponge.
Okay. So, bovine spongiform. I should have known better. Bovine spongiform encephalopathy.
Encephalopathy.
Or mad cow disease.
Ah, okay. Shit.
Yeah, dude. They got deep on this one. I like it. I really do. I think they did a great job of writing some lyrics right there.
They're not dumb guys.
No, they're not. And I'm certainly not. This is New York hardcore, Mark Radulich. They're in your face. You know, the aggression.
Oh, I'm on your case. I'm in your face. See you and your father back in blaze. Step up, sucker. Understand? Don't you know? I'm the man.
All right. So anyway, no, I'm not accusing them of being dumb in any way, but I think that, you know, wow, for an aggressive type song, deep lyrics or stuff like using the word spongiform is definitely a way of showing you that, hey, we're smart too. So I tip my hat to the man that wrote these lyrics. Now, number two, what the hell did you send me?
Yeah, I need you to look at that real quick.
Oh, boy. MAGA building block set. Hooray, hurrah. From ABC Action. It's just one big fucking wall. we'll be talking about the wall here pretty soon on one of these tracks, actually.
Yeah, it's a Lego set that encourages you to build a wall.
Oh, that's great. There to build a wall. So, you know what? I was watching the 90s documentary that CNN did. It's on Netflix right now. And me and the wife are episode 3 or episode 4, and they're talking about some of the political landscape of the 90s. And we just got through George Bush running against Clinton in 92. And one of the quotes, I believe this was made in 2017 or 2018, one of the quotes that they decided to use was Bill Clinton up on the podium saying he was going to make America great again. I looked over at my wife and said, that sounds familiar. So anyway, MAGA building blocks. Hooray, hurrah.
See, okay. When Democrats say it, it's fine. When, you know,
I'm not going there. shouldn't either. Not right now.
Just
not
saying.
Ever.
No, I'm. Look, you brought it up, and I feel the need to comment on it.
So anyway, speaking of commentary, you know, one of the things that you pointed out to me that I thought was kind of strange, and
was
I kind of
that
dismissed
if liberals
it
say something, it's okay, but if conservatives say the exact same thing,
can I bring your attention back to the podcast, back to the fans?
I'm sorry,
about.
Sir.
Sick of it all.
A thousand pardons. I apologize.
So, me and you were watching the, what was the name of that first video where they were giving us an instructional video on dances?
That's what I was going to ask you, actually. Like, as you're listening to these songs, are you, like, picturing the guys dancing in your head?
Oh, yes. What was the name of that video again?
Step Down.
Step Down. Okay. All right. So, one of the things you mentioned was about how, I think you said something about it's all about the love, especially when that one guy goes over and shakes the hand of the reporter that's there to talk about the dirty deeds that are going on down underneath this New York hardcore scene.
Fuck yeah, dude.
And I was like, okay, didn't
Kid Rock teach us that to get in the pit and try to love someone?
I hear you. But this is such an aggressive type of music, and people are in the pit bouncing off of each other. Hardcore Horseshoe is, if you look at the lyrics of that song and listen to what they're saying, it is a song about people getting into the experience of a concert. And I think that right there, that song is a great representation of the love that you can feel at a concert with all these people you have no idea who they are, usually. You may know a few, but they're there for the sound, and that's what the sound does. That's what New York hardcore is all about. It's all about the love. And Mark Radlich, again, I have been educated, man. I have learned something. This and this band, I think there may be one more song. I can't remember if it's this next. I don't think it is. I think it's Hardcore Horseshoe. It's all about the love of their music and the love of that music and the love that people should have for each other. As a matter of fact, I think one of the lyrics in there am I on the right song? No, I'm not. Here we go. Hardcore Horseshoe. Here we go. Lose your mind. Don't lose your temper, or there'll be hell to pay. So it's interesting to hear them. Go ahead. Be aggressive. But listen, we're all here to have fun. So I like that, Mark. I do.
That's right. Kick your friend in the face friendly.
Don't get pissed. We're here to have a good time.
That's right.
That's great stuff.
You get in the pit and try to love someone.
Oh, boy. I want to go watch that video now. Specifically, our commentary on it.
All right. So these next ones are called Mental Furlough, Deep State, and Bad Hombre. Hombre.
Society, I am right and you are wrong. So we must
Starting to go here, so we're going to wrap this up shortly. We had Mental Furlough, Deep State, and Bad Hombres. Deep State, very highly political song. I liked that last line right before I switched over to Bad Hombres about, you know, identity politics and all of that. It was all good. You know, I was listening to this at work the other day, and you know, when I'm not paying, it's kind of what I was saying about the Robert Moses thing. Like, if you're just putting it on in the background, nothing is really going to jump out at you and be like, wait, Robert Moses, and like stop working.
Wait a second.
You know, like if you just put it on, you don't pay attention to the track names.
Yeah.
It's, you know, it's just a nondescript hardcore punk album.
Yeah. Well, you know, I tagged you in the lyrics for this song. And the reason why is because I believe Deep State is probably, of all of the songs that we've listened to so far this year on the Metal Hammer of Doom, this one I identify with the most. You know, if you're on social media as much as I am, which you shouldn't be, ladies and gentlemen, you should stay off Facebook as much as you can, you will see almost every bit of it represented in the lyrics of this song. And I, even though this is a band I've not known for the past 30 years.
Can I just say something?
Yes.
To the people on Facebook, I want you to understand something. Twitter's a little bit different, but it's kind of the same concept, but especially with Facebook. Let me explain how Facebook works. Facebook is a closed circle. The only people that see what you put on Facebook, unless they're linked to it in some way, are the people who choose to follow you, which are, unless you're a celebrity, your friends and family.
Mm-hmm.
Donald Trump isn't following you on Facebook. So when you go on Facebook and write, fuck you, Donald Trump, he doesn't see it.
No, he does not.
I see it. Jessie sees it.
That's right.
Your mom sees it. But your intended target, it's not the same as going in front of the White House and pulling out your cock and saying, this is for you, Trump! You know,
yeah.
I
lot of what I see is, it seems like there are so many people trying to institute a movement of some sort. Like, okay, this is what's gone wrong today. Here you go. This is how our nation has been wronged. This is how this certain sect of people have been wronged. And I believed a long time ago that if people are already set in their ways, you're not going to change them.
But that's the thing. It's like I share stuff on Facebook because the expectation is that my friends and family will read it and they'll learn something, or, you know, or they'll be better off for it, or it'll be like, oh, that's interesting. There's a woman who, you know, I used to be friends with. We don't really see each other much anymore. But she puts all the stuff about sex up because she's trying to educate people, and she's really passionate about it. Like, she's passionate about polyamorous relationships, and she's passionate about, for one thing, she's in one, or two, or three. get it?
On the math.
But no, like, her family is polyamorous, and, you know, and she's got, like, a doctorate in kinkology or some shit. That's a real thing, by the way. And so these are subjects she's passionate about. Like, I don't give a shit about any of that stuff. But she shares a lot of articles and things that she's interested in because she's trying to educate people. And some of the stuff is interesting. Some of the stuff I've actually shared that she shared as well. Not necessarily a lot of the sex stuff, you know, unless it's people fucking trees, because, you know.
That's got to be shared.
Yeah, because the world must know. But you know, but like I share a lot of movie news, whatever. You know, I share a lot of finance news because I don't want people to be surprised when Trump's reelected, which they will be anyway.
I've been telling everybody since you told me, Mark Radulich.
Have you?
I'm telling everybody. And I told my wife. I said, "Are you ready for him to be elected a second time?"
And what'd she say?
Oh, she. The side eye, Mark Radulich. There is no words. It's the side eye.
Did you tell her that it was my explanation that convinced you?
Yes, it was. I said, "Listen, people right now are going to vote for the person that's getting the job done. And if there isn't anything horribly wrong with the economy, then most people they're going to go with the safe bet."
Right, and she gave you the side eye.
I get. Mark Radulich, there isn't a day I don't get the side eye, so.
It's just. Marriage. What a wonderful institution.
Indeed. Polyamory, you saying?
Anyway, but I just. I know you were saying what you needed to say, but it just reminded me, like, there's a guy that I was friends with in high school, not the one that was do not engage, different guy.
Tell that guy that I used his quote. Quite often from here on out.
Yeah, I don't follow him on Facebook anymore, but I might message him anyway and be like, "I just want you to know that your do not engage inspired another friend to steal that bit." Anyway, but I'm just trolling through Facebook one day, and this one kid that I went to school with, you know, he's just like, "Fuck you, Donald Trump," and blah blah yakety schmackety, and I just want to write him back like, "He can't read this. What are you doing? I'm reading this. I didn't do anything to you." Like,
yeah.
Like, it's...
I know, it, man.
You know, like I don't think people... It's like, I don't think people understand how social media works. You know? And then, it's like, you're that angry with the president. Like, I don't take anything away from people's anger with the president. Your anger is your own. Whatever your issues are, or perceived slights or whatever, that's fucking on you. Again, there's a gal who... I know through another person who's like way liberal and way political, you know, and she's always putting up stuff, and some of it I like, and some of it I'm like, eye roll, but, you know, and she was definitely one of those people with the fucking vagina hat and everything else. You know, when 5 minutes after President Trump was elected, you know, she was one of the women thinking, "Well, that's it, abortion's dead, you know, we're all gonna be forced to have 10,000 babies. Or some shit.
Oh, jeez.
You know, she was one of those people, and it was like, okay, have your fucking moment here. You know, like,
yeah,
I,
let's take a breath and then go sleep it off. Wake up tomorrow. There, believe it or not, the world will still be here when you get up tomorrow.
Strangely
It'll be
enough,
okay.
Strangely enough, so will abortion. So don't worry about it. But it, you know, but it's like I see people like that, and it's like. You know, you're entitled to be angry about whatever it is you're angry about, but direct it in the right way at the people who are offending you. You know, it's literally like, I'm angry about guns, so I punched my kid. That's...
I know. That got the job done, didn't it?
Yeah, it's like, not the intended target, you know? It's like, hey, I'm mad about abortion. Come here, cat. Meow! I'm gonna fuck this here kitty. Wait, what?
Wait a second. Don't make me do it.
President Trump, you build that wall or I'll fuck this cat. Wait, what?
I see where you're coming from because we see it every day on social media. Here lately, I've gotten so sick and tired of hearing people bitch about it. You know, I just, like, sick of it all. Here they are. They just dropped this album. They got a lot of commentary. The one thing that I would ask them if I ever had the chance would be, did you go vote?
Right.
Did you put your money where your mouth is and go vote? Because if you're wanting to change something, okay, aside from the riots that we have some artists requesting that everybody do, you know, a revolution or whatever, the most feasible thing you could do is go and exercise your right to do to try and change things. And people don't do that. They'd rather sit. 90% of who I see bitching on Facebook probably didn't vote.
Love to see, like, Ministry, Sick of It All, OTEP, like, do just one big show together, and then at the end of it, they all just jerk each other off. Just one giant, we're tired of it, circle jerk.
riots ensue. I don't know. I mean, look, the good thing about Sick of It All, the one thing, a good thing I could say about Sick of It All, specifically this song Deep State, makes me realize that they are aware of what's going on around them, because there's a lot of commentary in that song about what's going on social media and how the media are using their clout to steer whatever. You know, one of the things they say, each side is reciting, "I'm right and you're wrong." Sowing more division was intent all along. Media corporations spin the coverage, write the reviews.
Sick of, like, people, like, the media. I was recently listening to a Lewis Black comedy album, and he was talking about how, like, the next time there's a weather disaster, the weather reporters need to get a rabies shot.
Okay. All right.
He's like, "It's fucking snow. Relax."
I don't know. I'm a big believer in the fact that the media is going to will spin things as best as they can to try and fucking Ice-T even said the media loves a. I think his quote is the media loves a fight off of Bloodlust, off that album. They just instigate because they love a fight, and you know, I believe that. I'm right there with them.
My favorite moment, and this is when I knew like that, like 24-hour cable news was completely full of shit. And, you know, it should be taken with a grain of salt. This is during the Bush administration, okay?
Okay.
Let me ask you a question. If I said there's a news alert, just give me a rough idea in your head of what do you think a news alert might be?
A news alert would be the thing that comes across the screen. We got a little bit of a sound bite along with it. Dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun.
Yeah, but I mean, like what would constitute a news alert? What would be happening in the world?
Some kind of a war. How's that?
All right. Anything else?
Some kind of attack of some sort, explosion, something like that. Is that? Am I going the right direction here?
I mean, there's no wrong answer.
Okay.
Well, there is a wrong answer. What actually happened? But I wanted. But in order for this story to work, I need to hear what would you normally think would constitute a news alert? The necessity of a news alert.
Yeah, the necessity of a news alert would definitely be some type of an attack, like a plane crash, something along those lines.
Okay. Maybe another school shooting. Though those are happening those shootings are happening often. And, you know, have you been watching South Park lately?
No, I don't watch every that.
Time,
I don't watch
show. Every time they show the school in, every time they show the school in South Park, all you hear is gunshots.
Oh, it's horrible.
It's awesome. Gosh. It's so funny. Anyway, so I remember back in the Bush administration, Bush the second, Bush Jr. Okay. I was at my friend's house. It was at his apartment. And this is after 9/11, right? So we're a little on edge. And we see Fox News alert. Bam! The audience is now anxious.
That's the truth, ladies and gentlemen.
And we're like, oh, God, what's happening? Have we been attacked again? Like, my friend, like, there's only a couple of seconds between the bong and then, like, the start of the story. So we don't have a lot of time to process it. But both me and my friend, like, stopped what we were doing, and we were glued to the TV. Oh, no, what could be constituting a Fox News alert? You want to know what it was?
Tell me.
The Dodgers had left Brooklyn. No. Woo! Waka waka.
Christopher Rattledge no longer likes baseball.
Film at 11. What the actual... people say I should be a stand-up comedian. What the actual news alert was that Tony Blair and Bush had landed in Washington.
That was the alert.
Yes.
A plane has safely landed with two very important people on board.
That's correct. The president and the prime minister landed safely and disembarked the vehicle.
Gosh.
Fox News
alert. Isn't that sick? It's sick. It's sickening. Yeah. Just because they want... Yeah, well, we could go on and on about
But that's why I think the media is full. So it's like the media can't fucking tie its shoes, let alone, you know, be in control of some sort of conspiracy.
It's just horrible and so... Well, okay. All right. So you think they can't do the... I think that if they are attempting a conspiracy... They're doing it horribly, because I, for one, can see right through it. Now, the problem is that with social media itself, how many people do you see share shit from sites that have no business even putting a story out?
It drives me crazy. Like, our good friend Pat tends to share stuff from one particular site, and I'm like, that's a fake news site, dude. Stop doing it.
Why are you... And then all these people take that shit, with as fucking gospel, because they saw it on Facebook.
He fucking retweets from, like, Occupy Democrats, and every time he does, I was like, take a Xanax.
And then, you know, here lately, I've been seeing people, like, post shit about stuff, and I go in there, and people are, you know, sharing this thing left and right, and it's like a three-year-old story. Some kid's been missing for 3 years, but they've decided... that even though he was found a month after he became missing, the fucking thing is still circulating on Facebook because people think this kid is missing. And when legitimately he was found, it says that in like the first comment on the fucking thing. But nope, we got to share it, Mark Radlich, because it says, guess what? Please share.
All right.
So please share this podcast. We appreciate it.
Yes. And please share this podcast, but start it with Dear Donald Trump. Fuck you.
I'm sick of it and tired of it.
Please tag your mother in that post. All right, speaking of tag your mother, these are our last two songs, Work the System and The New Slavery. Do you feel the pressure, Jessie Sutcher?
Oh, my goodness. Whew. So, yeah, Work the System, okay? I think that is a socialism song, I believe.
I think it was... what I gathered from the song, it was like they were encouraging people to take, you know, to cheat the system because like, CEOs cheat their companies and cheat people, and so... it's all gravy. Just, you know, get yours.
Okay. And then we go to The New Slavery, which is a very interesting song. Song about, I think, debt and money and the fact that government is pretty much just a bunch of corporate stooges anyway. It's all corporate by design is one of the things that they say in that song.
You ready to go into hock for the next year for Christmas?
And what?
I said, are you ready to go into hock for Christmas this year?
Oh, I don't know. Is that like in big time debt?
Yeah.
Oh boy. You know, I could tell you probably an hour's worth of stories about making bad decisions with credit cards. And oh, we have not got time for that. But yeah, Christmas times are coming, ladies and gentlemen.
The goose is getting fat. Please put a penny in the old man's hat.
I'll never forget Danny Trejo in Reindeer Games saying that we should, the government or somebody should come up with a Christmas 2. Right in the middle of the year, so we can kind of spread things out. Christmas would be great, you know, if Jesus just could have waited around till the end of tax season. So I could have got my refund and then celebrated Christmas. Search for White Christ, ladies and gentlemen. 17 songs on this puppy. It's a little overwhelming, but I think you can do it. The album is worth a listen, if not for the commentary alone. If you don't like their sound, you might like their message, or vice versa. Unfortunately for me, there's not a whole lot I grasped onto that I really, really loved. While I enjoy some of the messages they are providing, Sick of It All is, you know, they got that frantic New York hardcore sound that I'm sometimes into, sometimes I'm not.
I'm going to give it a solid B.
Damn you. Let me get my rating out.
Oh, sorry.
Solid B. I'm giving it 26th spot overall, right above where they found probably good company, OTEP, Cult 45.
Right below White Christ.
But they have not made it on. That's clearly going to be number one, Mark Radulich. If I give White Christ the number two, I mean, my goodness. But yes, right below Skindred, Big Tings. Sick of It All
Big
runs.
Big Tings!
Big Tings, Mark Radulich, Big Tings. But hey, I enjoyed it. I'm glad I had the chance to listen to it and talk. A lot of commentary. You know, some of these albums I may not be a big fan of, but boy, do they bring the conversation.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I mean, I enjoyed tonight's show. Like, the music was kind of like, here's the thing. Like, I love Scratch the Surface. I could listen to Scratch the Surface again and again and again. I really enjoy that album. But a lot of Sick of It All gets a little samey. And, like, I wanted to do the album because, I'm, you know, again, it's more of like a nostalgia thing for me. I was a huge fan of theirs in high school. I was a huge fan of that album. But since Scratch the Surface, they've all, you know, it's just been a lot of, it's kind of like with NOFX for me. Like, I loved the early NOFX stuff. And now, like, I hear another album, I was like, yep, Fat Mike's still angry. Cool. You know? They're not doing a whole, they're not really stretching the genre at all. They're not really doing anything interesting with it. And, you know, I like hardcore punk, but it's like I listen to it and I go, okay, well, we're good here. Thanks. See you in a few years.
Yeah. It's like, you know, the sound doesn't feel like it really evolves a whole lot, I would say. And it's more about the message and the times that is going on around the music and that's in the music. That's probably the biggest change you could probably gauge, I would assume.
Yeah.
So, but that's punk for you.
So, I'm just looking at Unleashed on Spotify.
Oh, wait a second. What's the name of the new album?
Oh, you didn't know? So, the five most popular songs right now are all from The Hunt for White Christ.
Oh, boy. Oh, boy. Well, did you say you've listened to this band before?
Yes, back in
okay.
Back when I gave a Catholic, a Mexican Catholic boy,
how could I forget this story?
A copy of an Unleashed album, much to his mother's chagrin.
How could I forget this story? So yeah,
How could you not love an album where the song titles are "Stand Your Ground," "Lead Us Into War," "The Hunt for White Christ," "You Will Fall," "Graham," "Terror Christ." They rape the land. Eh?
Eh? Eh? Christ and rape. There you go. Okay.
Then let's see. Dawn of the Nine. You've got a new dawn. A new day will rise. They came to die. Defenders of Midgard. God, I wanted to end this podcast a half an hour ago. Fuck me. Shut up, Mark.
Unleashed has a new album coming out, or that has been out. Oh boy. Well, Mark, I had a good time tonight, man. Are you ready to close up shop?
Goddamn right I am.
All right, then. I guess get into plugs.
Make me. No.
I want to go to bed. No, wait.
I don't know what I want. I'm a girl.
Shout out to all you ladies.
All the single ladies. All the single ladies. All right. So tomorrow, Andrew Graham will be on TV Party Tonight. We're celebrating Veterans Day a few days late. We're going to look at Our World War, which if you get a chance, it's only three episodes long. It's 3 hours of your time. You should definitely give it a shot. It's got that new style of, like, you know, the History Channel thing where, like, they dramatize an actual historical event. And, like, the, you know, the filming of the event is as close to real as possible, but it's dramatized for your entertainment. And it's about World War One. So, you know, and it's pretty graphic. You know, as far as, like, you know, people getting shot in battle and all that. Earlier this week, we did Deadpool Kills the Marvel Universe with Alexis Haina and Justin Thomas. Myself and Robert Winfrey had a long discussion about how women would actually like some help and, you know, can't do it all despite Hollywood telling you otherwise. Oh, yeah, and then we talked about The Grinch.
I don't understand how those two relate, but okay.
You'll have to see the movie.
All right, then.
And next week... Oh, fuck a duck. Next week, we'll have Gavin Napier of the Sometimes Recording Casual Heroes. We'll be looking at his favorite Justice League story, The Tornado's Path. And I will say things like, I like cheese a lot. myself and Robert Winfrey will be reviewing Fantastic Beasts, The Crimes of Grindelwald. And then we are at our annual pre-Thanksgiving show, our turkey show, as we like to call it. We find a silly album and we review it to the enjoyment of all. In this case, we're actually looking at a new album instead of an old one. From earlier this year, Huba Stank, Push Pull. And then the next night, Robert Cooper and Jessie Starcher will give you an entire extra show. After you have eaten the turkey and taken the nap and watched the football and fucked the cat...
No, wait a second. At some point, we're going to be talking about cranberry sauce. I don't know if you forgot about that or not.
Oh, that's right. After you done fuck that cranberry can.
Oh, it can. It can.
Oh, it can. You know, I have to wonder, like, when our European listeners, you know, hear these shows, and they hear me talking about fucking a can of cranberry sauce, they're like, what is happening in America? Is it Trump's fault? Is that what's happened?
Things have taken a dark turn.
He grabbed him in the pussy and fucked a can of cranberry sauce. That's what happened, folks.
Well, all right, then.
So anyway, after you've had your way with the cranberry sauce... you can tune into an extra show, Metal Hammer of Doom, Throssenblatt, whatever the new one is. I'm sure it's got some crazy name I can't pronounce. And then we wrap up November with Hawkeye, Volume 1, My Life is a Weapon, is brought to you by Matt Fraction. Myself and a much chagrined Robert Winfrey, against his will, will be reviewing the new Robin Hood, which looks like trash.
He just can't stop adding that to it.
Oh,
must
last,
be one of the greatest movies of all time.
Last night I said to Winfrey, I was like, I'm pretty sure Jesse Starcher thinks that's the name of the movie, that Robin Hood movie that looks like trash. He's like, why'd they name it that? I don't know.
That's the weirdest name. I'm unreal. I don't understand how this can succeed.
And then we move on with the Metal Hammer of Doom. We close out November with the boys that go boom, Dreadheart and Company, POD Circles. And then on the 29th, there will be an on trial for the Robin Hood Prince of Thieves with Kevin Costner. And then finally, on December 1st, myself, Pat Mullen, possibly Gavin Napier, will be doing live commentary over Deontay Wilder versus Fat Tyson Fury.
All right. Well, ladies and gentlemen, go give the Rattlitch in Broadcasting Network Facebook page a like to stay up on top of all the great podcasts that we have to offer. We're right here at home on Spreaker.com, but you can find us also on Stitcher, iTunes, TuneIn Radio, Deezer, baby, and a whole host of other podcast platforms, especially Spotify. If you like listening to music and then you like to listen to us talk about music, hey, that's a good idea. Listen to us talk about the album and then go find the album and listen to it. Holy shit, you can do it all.
You can go on your own hunt for White Christ.
And please, post updates. Tag us all on Twitter and all that great stuff. Make sure to tweet us. Let us know how the search goes.
Please post a letter to Donald Trump on your Facebook page that you're looking for White Christ.
And you're asking for assistance. You need help. Hopefully the search will not be long. But yes, you can stay up on top of all that great podcast action by typing in RADULICH in the search box. Subscribe, like, rate, do all that great stuff. Mark Radlich, I'm ready to get out of here. I'm going to search for the bed here in about a couple seconds, make sure I find it.
You're going to search for the white mattress?
Yes, and plop my fat ass right down on it and go right to sleep.
All right, for White Jesse Starcher, I'm your...
No denial here.
I'm your host, the Mandated Reporter, and frankly, I'm mortified, Mr. Mark Radlich. This has been the Metal Hammer of Doom. We're awfully silly. Please join us again, won't you? Be well, be safe, and behave.
Your heart out at oldnavy.com with jeans on sale for one day only today. That's right, Old Navy jeans are just $10 for adults and $8 for kids and toddlers. Online only at oldnavy.com. Valid 11/26, select styles only.